Hello to everybody. Good morning, good evening, good afternoon. I'm happy to welcome you to this webinar on how to make best use of the Ramsar Sites Information Service. I assume you are familiar with the Zoom application. We suggest that you, if you have a question, write it in the Q&A. And submit it to everybody, then we try to answer it. If you wish to put the question rather orally, select the raise hand, because the webinar will have two parts. I will give a first introductory part, and then there will be a more detailed explanation. And after the first part and after the second part, we will have enough time to discuss, to take your questions either orally or respond to those which have been submitted in writing. I'm now going to share my screen with the PowerPoint, and I hope you see it, my screen now, how to make best use of the Ramsar Sites Information Service. So just to present myself, which is done, and Isabel, my colleague, will speak to you in the second half in more detail. So now we can continue. First of all, maybe just to remind all of us why we are supposed to compile information on Ramsar site and make this information up to date, because this is essential data for each wetland of international importance. Which is encapsulated in the Ramsar Information Sheet, RIS. And this allows analysis and comparison around the world. Everybody can do that on the public side, and one can also do more sophisticated analysis with the database behind it. And that is baseline data, which is used also by other institutions, like the United Nations, like the Sustainable Development Goals, and other processes. So the Ramsar parties have decided that they wanted to have a Ramsar information sheet already long time ago in a resolution, and that they should provide updated Ramsar information regularly interval. And since 2015, this is fully online through the internet, and therefore much easier to handle. Updated information means that no information in the information sheet should be older than 6 years, but this can be updated in a rolling basis, which we will go and look into it in more detail. So as I said before, this is the first introduction where I give you the general parts, and then my colleague Isabel will go into details and explain to you also the two parts of the Ramsar Sites Information System, RSIS. There is the public one, which everybody can access to. So the information you are uploading there is publicly available. And then there is the internal part, which can only be seen by those who are compiling Ramsar site information, or by the national Ramsar focal points in the AA administrative authority. And we go through these 7 points, which you have listed here later on today. And we will obviously answer your question. So maybe we can make briefly a few polls. I may ask my colleague maybe to ask you a question through a first poll. You click on the answer you think is the right one, and you have about a minute or so, and then we'll see what the answers are. I think you should be seeing the poll number one now. What is the total area of all Ramsar sites globally? Just click on what you think is the right answer. And here now you should be seeing the result. Indeed, those who have voted for 254 million hectares, have got the right answer. So more than half of you did get the right answer. This is about the size between Argentina and Kazakhstan, just to give you an idea. And the global area for Ramsar site continues obviously to grow with when one adds additional Ramsar sites. Maybe let's do a second poll. So that is simply asking, have you already used the Ramsar site information service yet? Or is that, have you not done so? Just click one of the three answers. Then we see a little bit better where we should focus our explanations. Okay, now I think we've seen all, we see all the result. Most of you, or two thirds of you, have already logged into the RSIS yet, so it's not completely new. And for those who tried without success, I think we can solve that problem today. And for the rest, we'll do also the same. So thank you. Let's go now to the next slide. Okay. So I did say there is a public portal, and the second is obviously protected by a password, which is given to you if you're completing a Ramsar information sheet or if you are a national focal point. And that's for the work we are doing between you and us to make sure that the information is logical, is coherent, and as complete as possible. So the Ramsar information sheet, as I said, can be filled in by somebody who is registered with us as a national Ramsar focal point and works for the AA, the Ramsar Administrative Authority, or that person, the national focal point, can ask us to give this password for compilation of Ramsar information to additional person who may be manager of specific Ramsar sites, which is now just written here as RC Ramsar site sheets compilers, and I assume all of you are either or the other category. The national focal point in the administrative authority keeps the control, and it is him or her who will eventually send the new information or the updated information to us. So that person has the control of what should be the information which is transmitted by the country to us, to the secretariat. This is the workflow, which shows a bit how that works. So in light green is the administrative authority. You open up a new Ramsar information sheet for a new site or for an update. Maybe it is in dark green, a different person who fills in the information, compiles the information and submits it to the administrative authority, or it may be the same person. And then it is submitted to the orange part, the regional team here at the secretariat. So myself and Isabel, who speaks to you afterwards, we are dealing with Ramsar information sheets for European countries. There are other colleagues who do the same for Asian, African, American, Oceanian Ramsar sites. And if we have questions, then we come back to the compiler, to the administrative authority, trying to clarify this. That is the workflow. And if you worry about if that was too quick, the webinar, which we are doing now, is recorded and can be found on our website afterwards. So you can download the record there and look at it back in more time, with more time, or you can also ask us to send you the slides or so which you are seeing right now. Another important aspect which we would like to speak about here is that it is important also to upload a boundary shape file which shows exactly what is the boundary of the Ramsar site. This is done with a geographical information system nowadays. And why is it important? Because there are other parallel processes like the Sustainable Development Goals, notably also the one number 15, which is about protecting, restoring, and promoting sustainable use of terrestrial ecosystems, manage sustainable forests, combat desertification, halt and reverse land degradation, and biodiversity loss. And that goal has an indicator 15.1.2, which is measuring the proportion of important sites for terrestrial and freshwater biodiversity that are covered by protected areas. So how much of the surface of a country is covered by protected areas. This is also a target under the Biodiversity Convention, the so-called Aichi target, which was adopted in Aichi 10 years ago, which said at that time that 17% of inland and 10% of coastal and marine areas should be protected. You have the formal text written here. As you know, the countries will meet again in a few months' time to update those Aichi targets in the new global framework for biodiversity, and possibly those percentage of protected areas go up to 30%, so that 30% of inland and 30% of coastal marine areas should be protected. So it's important that one can measure this with such shapefiles, which then give the surface. And it is also important that the information obviously is up to date, because as I said at the beginning, that was decided already back in 1996, because missing or outdated data, they corrupt a meaningful analysis. And this is not only then a problem for Ramsar and the Convention on Wetlands, but it's also a problem for those other processes like the Sustainable Development Goal, the Agenda 2030 of the United Nations, or comparable processes under the Convention on Biodiversity and other processes under the United Nations Environment Programme. As I said before, with the whole system being based on the internet, you can now make a very simple system of a rolling update. If you think some information has changed and needs to be updated, open your RAS update and do update those information fields which need to be updated. The other fields where you're not touching upon is considered still to be all right, up to date, it hasn't changed. And then it's done, because then the 6-year count, the machine starts counting again as of today. And that is a rolling update. So you don't have a big amount of work to do in 6 years when you have to check everything. If you do this on a regular basis, it's much easier. So that was the general introduction for this afternoon. I don't know yet if we have got some questions or so. I don't think so. If anybody of you has a question, please raise your hand. We can respond to it immediately. If that's not the case, then let's go briefly to the next session. I will just show you still two pictures before Isabel will take on. So I said there is the public portal, which looks a little bit like this, the landing page. When you start going to it, you see the world map, you can zoom into that. And then there is the internal, the password protected portal, which is just for you and us. And Isabel will now tell you more about that, unless there is an urgent question which has come up. In the meantime, I don't think that's the time. So we are very, before Isabel takes over, let's still do two more polls. Maybe my colleague Kati can help us with poll number 3. Another question up for you now. Have you used the export functionality of the platform? You can export information from the platform. Just give us a rapid answer. Kati, can you close the poll? Okay. Most of the people here in the webinar say they have not yet used the export facility or functionality. So Isabel will explain this. And one or two have actually used it already very often. And just the last question before I'm handing over. Poll number four, please. Oh yes, this, the question is, it's a bit bad formulated, sorry. The point is, where those of you who have used already the RSIS and tried to include data there, the question is, you have three choices. Where did you have most problems in part of the RAS? Was it mostly with the criteria and the justification of the criteria? Was it more with the species lists, or was it with something else? It sounds that the criteria and their justification seems to pose most problems or issues, and that's actually true, because this is also what we are checking carefully, because that's very important. So Isabel will certainly focus very much so on her explanations. In the meantime, there have been two questions coming in, and I'm just reading them out. So maybe then Isabel can, when she goes through her presentation, address them, or we come back to it at the end if it wasn't clear enough. If a file is opened, it seems to show up as updated, regardless of whether material was changed or validated. Should there be a separate button to verify that the relevant authority considers the material up to date and submitted? So that is the question about the process, from which moment on is updated information validated and submitted. Isabel will explain this. And sure, the recordings will be made available to all of you after the webinar, so that you will get a message when it's ready, all of you, those who have registered. So I think with that, we have checked the questions which were submitted in written, and I'm handing over to Isabel, and stop sharing my screen if I find the right button.
I think you already stopped.
Okay, great.
Thanks, Tobias. Hello again, I'm Isabel. Some of you probably already know me through email. I'm also going to share my screen to, first of all, show you the public portal of the RSIS. I hope you can see it. So this is what it looks like. Today I will be using a staging environment, so I can play around a little bit with the RSIS without changing actual essential information. So the public portal and also the private portal is available in all three official Ramsar languages. You can change the languages here. In the public portal, you first of all see the map with all of the Ramsar sites as dots. You can play with the map and add additional layers or change from centroids to polygons. You can also see all the Ramsar sites in a list. You can sort by site name, country, designation date, number, or area. Then we have a statistics view with three different graphs, the site number and year, the site number and area by year, site number and area by region, and the percentage of Ramsar criteria. Here on the left-hand side, you have a search and filter function, which is very useful. In the search box, you can, of course, search for a Ramsar site by name or for a specific species that you're looking for. I would encourage you, if there's a question mark, always check what's behind. Here, for example, it is explained how to better search, so you will get to your results sooner. There's also filters on this side. For example, I now only want all of the Ramsar sites from Switzerland. So I choose Europe, look for Switzerland, and I only want to see Ramsar sites that are human-made, that include human-made wetlands. So I also click this filter, I can see all of the filters here on top. And now I can only see the Ramsar sites that I filtered for. Also, same in the map view. If I click on one of those Ramsar sites, I will be directed to the details of that site that everybody can see. So there's a summary of the site. You can see the boundaries, and you can, of course, download the RAS, the archived RASs, and the sitemap, and any additional reports and documents that were provided by the administrative authority. And you can see the picture as well. We talked about the exports function. So now I've made my selection. I've selected all of the Swiss Ramsar sites with human-made wetlands. And maybe I want to do some analysis with these Ramsar sites. For example, I want to see which criteria they have in common. So I go to export, and I can export information in an Excel file format, CSV file format, or a PDF. I can click on generate, and then an Excel file is generated. If you're not logged in like I am, you might have to add your email address here, and then the file is automatically sent to you, and you can make analysis with the data that is provided by the RSIS. So this was the public part of the RSIS. And if you are a national focal point or a Ramsar site compiler, you can click on Manage My Sites, where you can add the important information. So you will land on this dashboard, which looks like this. I would recommend to first go on the help section, where you can find information on how to use this system, and you find the RSIS tutorials on YouTube. Also, this video, this recording of today, will be on our YouTube channel. Very important is also the strategic framework, which gives you information on the whole RIS, and especially on the different criteria and the justifications, as this was a question you asked before. And you can also download a blank offline Word form of the RIS. I will talk about that a little bit later. So back to the dashboard with the existing sites. Down here, you can see all designated Ramsar sites from Switzerland. So today I'm pretending to be the administrative authority of Switzerland. So I can see all of the Swiss sites that have been designated. All of the sites are up to date. I can see when they were last published and when they were designated. I have a few sites that I'm currently working on. I can see those sites here. They're either new sites or just being updated. I can see the status, whether they are with the administrative authority, the Ramsar compiler, or with the regional team. So with us, with the secretariat. If you want to create a new site, you just click on create new Ramsar site. You select your country, the language, and then you provide a name. I just call this test. And then as the administrative authority, I can choose the Ramsar compilers that should be able to work on the Ramsar information sheet by selecting them and just clicking on that little arrow. Or I can also remove them from their access. So now I will just create a new Ramsar site, and the designation process has successfully been launched for this test site. If I go back to my existing sites, back to my dashboard, I can see test is now here opened, and I can work on it. In order to launch an update, let's say I want to update this site 507, I just click on update. It's a very similar process. I can just continue, say, okay, I will update this. And now I have that site also here in the pending Ramsar sites. I can manage the compilers and give access to people who should then be able to work on that site, similar as before. I choose the people I want to be able to work at, choose them, I click save, and then go back to my dashboard. Okay, so now let's go through how to actually fill out the information in the Ramsar information sheet. So I'm choosing this Swiss site. I click on edit, and I will land on the homepage of the online RIS. This homepage gives me some background information on the online RIS, the designation process, how to compile the RIS, and what information is missing. I would recommend to go through all of this information to be clear on what to do. Here is also a small alert because we have just released a new feature, this little arrow, this orange icon that shows you when there has been changes to an update. For more information, you can also click here. So this RIS forum, or this RIS form, is made up of different sections. The first section is the summary. So the summary of the Ramsar site should just give an overview and should include details about the site's geography, its importance, the species composition, the importance of the site for people in the community, and possible threats. I would recommend to fill out the summary after you've completed all other sections of the RIS, to just give the bullet points here and leave the details for the individual sections of the RIS. If you make a change, please remember to always save. You can see I've just made a change. So I click on the save button, and then my change here is saved with the typo, so I can delete it and change it again. So it's gone. Under data and location, you have the formal data. Here, please provide the name and contact information of the RIS compiler. Below, you can provide the information of the National Ramsar Administrative Authority. This person is ultimately responsible for the content of the Ramsar information sheet. So it's important to see who at the time when it was being updated or created, who was responsible for that. Then you can give information about the period of collection of data and information used to compile the RIS. Please be aware that, of course, the data shouldn't be older than 6 years. Then you can provide the name in one of the official Ramsar languages. And you can also indicate if there have been changes to the boundaries and area of the site since its designation or an earlier update. And you can indicate if there have been changes to the ecological character of the site. Maybe you've seen this little red warning. So there are several mandatory fields in the RIS for which information must be provided. Otherwise, you cannot submit the RIS to us. So these sections are this section. So you need to provide information about the compilers and the administrative authority. You have to upload the GIS boundary, the digital map, the official area of the site, the criteria and their justification, and at least one photograph of the site. So let's move on to the site location where you can upload the GIS file. Just click on Browse and choose your file. If you click on the Help button, you see in which format the file should be. So a GIS file should please be uploaded as zip format, and needs, of course, to include these the four file types necessary for a geographical information system. Once you've uploaded it, you can see your uploaded JS file in this little map view. Again, here you can zoom in and out and choose different layers. Next, a digital map of the site also needs to be uploaded. So, a map should have several components to make it understandable. So there should be the name of the Ramsar site, a north arrow, a scale bar, and coordinates. And of course, the site itself and its boundaries. Please explain all features of the map. So if you have a land use map like here, please also include a legend which explains all of the features of the map or other boundaries, country boundaries that might be shown on the map. So it's really clear for the reader what they're looking at. So back to the RAS. A boundary description should accompany a map and make it clear to the reader why the Ramsar site boundary was drawn the way it was. So it's very good to relate the Ramsar site to other protected areas or landmarks, rivers, roads, or like I said, if there's another protected area that it overlaps with, please mention that. Then just some general information about the location. And the area of the site needs to be included. There's the official area, and also from the GIS file, the area is calculated. The official area of the site should not diverge more than 3% of the automatically calculated area. For further details, you can also always consult the strategic framework. Often if you just click on the help button, there's a direct link to the strategic framework. The PDF document which explains the whole RAS and gives details on how to fill out this whole form. So next we go to basically the heart of the RAS, the criteria. So why is this wetland a wetland of international importance? You can select the relevant criteria by just clicking on the arrow. Again, make sure to always save your progress. For instance, here we have selected criterion 1 and 2. If you select criterion 1, please always look at what is asked for as a justification and fill out the relevant boxes and fill out and be consistent and specific with the answers that you give that really helps the reader and us to understand why this wetland is important. For criterion 2, in criterion 2, you're asked to provide details on rare species. So to justify this criterion, please list important species in the species list. So either you click here, which will direct you to the species list, or in the drop-down menu, you can also see the plant species list, animal species list. I will just look at the animal species list for now and can see that all of the species that are rare and within this Ramsar site are listed here. And for them, criterion 2 is selected. So if we would want to add another species of international importance, for example, the northern bald ibis, I will just write the name I usually just write the first few letters of the name and then wait for the system to give me answers. So the system is connected to global species databases and automatically classifies this species as endangered, as you can see if I click on it. You can see here that this species is endangered under the IUCN Red List. It's in the CITES appendix and the CMS appendix, so it clearly qualifies as criterion 2. Click on criterion 2 and on add. If I realize, oh, this also qualifies for criterion 4, for example, I select this criterion and click on save. Now the system will give me a warning and say, okay, if I want to select criterion 4, I have to give a justification. So in the justification box, for example, the species is breeding here. Breeding, save again, and the species is saved to the list. If a species cannot be found in the database, please check the spelling and if there's another name for the species. If you still cannot find it, there is a text box at the bottom where you can add other species and the criterion. So moving on, the next section is to provide details about the Ramsar site. So here you can write a text about the ecological character of the Ramsar site. Next section is to choose the different wetland, to select the different wetland types. So after the Ramsar classification, so after the Ramsar classification, for example, we have an inland wetland here. So I select it's a freshwater wetland, it's flowing water, and my Ramsar site includes a permanent river. I can rank to the extent of this river within the Ramsar site, so from the greatest to the smallest, and then add that wetland type to the RAS. This section is also important for criterion 1. If a wetland type is a rare, representative, or unique example for its biogeographical region, please indicate this here and select criterion 1. Then you have biological components. You can add more species here that do not connect to one of the criteria, but are still noteworthy and occur within the Ramsar site. Also invasive alien species can be added here to this list. Let's move on to the physical components. And of course, it's not just animal species, but also plant species. So under the physical component section, you can give information about climate, geomorphic settings, soil, etc. There's always a drop-down menu or a multiple choice section. Please fill out all of this information. Even if the information is not available, you can click the arrow, no available information. Same with ecosystem services. Please provide information about the ecosystem services or benefits this wetland provides. So you can choose from the drop-down menu, the ecosystem service and an example, and then say how relevant it is for the respective Ramsar site and add this to the list. Again, if you want to explain things in more detail, feel free to add the information in the text box. And there's also a section for social and cultural values. So the next section is how the site is managed. There you can provide information about the land tenure and responsibilities. So who are the managers, who owns the land, and information about the management authority. So everybody's able to contact the responsible manager of the Ramsar site. Next section is about threats and responses. Again, here we have a kind of a list view. You can list the threat to the respective Ramsar site, which actual threat this factor that I chose poses to the Ramsar site, and the potential threat. Down below here again, you can add, you can put this into context, which is usually nice for the reader to understand what kind of threat there is to a Ramsar site. The next part I think is very self-explanatory. You can list which other conservation status this Ramsar site also has or overlaps with. Here, for example, this area is also a UNESCO Biosphere Reserve. Then you choose one of the IUCN protected areas category, explain the key conservation measures, and provide information about the management of the site. So if there is a site-specific management plan, please indicate that. And then please also provide a link to this management plan, or you can also add the management plan to the additional material section, which I will show in a minute. Other sections here are planning for restoration. You can indicate if there is a plan or if there should be a plan, or just choose from the drop-down menu. Same with monitoring. If you can indicate if monitoring is implemented or proposed by using the drop-down menu and the text box. So the final section of the RES is the additional material section. Okay, I have not saved. So the first part is the bibliographical references. So here you can please provide all the literature that you've used to fill out this Ramsar information sheet. We don't have a specific reference style, but please, we ask you to be consistent. Or you can also, like done here, add a reference list to the additional reports and documents section. This section allows you to add additional material, to add more detailed taxonomic lists, detailed ecological character descriptions, or like I mentioned, a management plan or other published literature. It's also mandatory to at least include one photograph of the site, but we encourage you to add as many high quality photographs as you can, because it makes the site more attractive in the public section. And also is nicer for the reader to see. Then a designation letter needs to be uploaded. If you have trouble finding the designation letter, please liaise with us. We might have a copy at the secretariat, and there is usually, there's a designation date indicated in the letter, which should be also indicated here. So once you've filled out all the information, you go to the submit section. This section will also remind you of all the warnings. So if you have not filled out one of these sections, you cannot submit and you will have to go back. It shows you with how much you have completed of the RES and the fields modified since the last update. Once everything is in order, you would just submit to administrative authority. So then, as we mentioned before, this comes back to us. As we mentioned before, once you submit it, the regional team receives your RAS, and we usually look through it and give comments if there's something missing. If we give a comment, we then send it back to you, and you will receive the RAS with these little icons here, this little bubble, which indicates that I have now commented on this section. You click on the comment and see that I've commented, please provide a boundary description. You resolve it and post a comment, save, and then here you provide your boundary description. Then again, you go back to save first, then you go back to submit. See if all of your comments are resolved and submitted back to the regional team. So the last part of the presentation is the offline form. So the offline form of the RAS helps the AA and the compilers to collect data without an internet connection or seek input from different local compilers or site managers that work offline. You can just click on export and create a Word export of the Ramsar site. Click here, and then an export of this RAS is created in a Word format. I can open this. Okay. Now I can see that all of the information that I've added is in the Word format. For example, here, the summary that was added is in the Word format. And then someone can make a change using Word and track changes. But it's important to note that the administrative authority then needs to add all of this information to the online version of the RSIS and send it back to us. So that's it. I hope I could give you a good insight into the RSIS, and I'm happy to receive your questions.
Yeah, thank you, Isabel. Maybe I will go through those questions which came in written, and then we'll see if my answers were good enough or if we continue in detail or if you have other questions. I think the process is important to know, as she showed, once you start open a site, either an update or a new one, then it is open, and then you can go back and forth with somebody here. In Europe, it's currently Isabel and you, and explore those questions in the comments and classify and solve them. But then when you think it's ready, everything has been done, then the National Focal Point has to formally submit it to us. And then we normally check again if it's fine, but maybe it's not even necessary. And then we are publishing the update on the internet, online. So that it's important to understand that procedure. So pending sites are the sites which are in this open process. Existing sites are the ones which have been completed already. So then there was a question about how much information is necessary. As she has explained, there is mandatory information where you will get a red alert when you want to submit and say you have not filled in all the fields there, and those red fields are mandatory. If not, you cannot submit it. The other ones, the orange messages, may be simply alerting you that there is very little information given or none, but it is not necessarily mandatory. We don't expect you necessarily to do sophisticated studies about data which you don't have yet on specific hydrological aspects or other aspects. If data information or is not existing, it is not needed in most of the fields, and we understand that. And so you don't have to do another study before updating RAS or submitting it to us. But Isabel said also use the most recent data. Don't necessarily use bird counts which are 20 years old if your bird watchers are making counts every winter or every breeding season or so. Use the most up-to-date one. So this is things which we are checking together with you if you are submitting such information. Why is a photo of the site mandatory? That was decided because the site, if you go to the public part, it's not only about the serious data and the monitoring, but it is also about communication to you, to other people, to the world about the site. So you will have in the public part, as you've seen, a nice summary, which should be easy to read and give a first picture, and then hopefully a picture of the site. Nowadays, it's easy to take a picture with your smartphone. We assume that the site manager or the person who fills in the RAS has an opportunity to take a picture and at least give one of the pictures. Add one of the pictures if you have more, that's fine as well. If you have pictures which are taken by a drone from above or so, even better. So, but of course, that is again according to what you have. You don't have to pay a photographer to do specific pictures, but it's in that sense of the need of communication. So there is a question about also how long does it take the regional team at the Secretariat to review that. Let's be clear about this. Normally we think it should take 2 hours, but there are 2,500 Ramsar sites in the world. In Europe, only more than 1,000. In the other regions are a few hundreds in each region. And we are only one, two persons here to deal with them. So if 100 new updates or 100 new Ramsar sites come in the same week, then it will be a little bit of a challenge for us to deal with all of them in the same week. But if they come in one by one, then obviously we try to get through that within 2 hours and come back to you rapidly. And then we hope that you at your end could answer the outstanding questions also rapidly. And then it should not take very much time, maybe a few days. And we are then sending it to our colleague who does the editing in the texts and the summary, make sure that the summaries are all in the same style and structure that you can easily compare between different Ramsar sites, and then it's published online. So there were a few more questions rather on the training. In the invitation which you have received for this webinar, we have explained that we have 3 levels of training. What we are just doing now and where we are coming to an end soon is the more introductory training, this webinar for people who are not familiar or very little familiar with the RAS, to tell you the general parts. Then we have different tutorial tests, which in the invitation, there are links. You can directly download them from there. If you go to the system, you can also download these tutorial texts from there. And there is a number of videos, 3 or 4 on specific subjects. So there are short 3-minute, 4-minute videos, which you have the link in the invitation, which is also available through our website on YouTube. So that may be giving you a more specific answer, or slowly, because you can stop the video, how to do specific things. And then if you still have another question or something which is complicated or doesn't work, right, don't hesitate to contact the relevant junior professional here. If it's in Ramsar site in Europe at Ramsar, or Isabel currently, Asia, Oceania, Americas or Africa, the emails are given also in the invitation to today's training. And now maybe, yes, the shape file, maybe before I'm handing over to Isabel for more detailed questions. The shapefile is important because that's used by UNEP and others also. So, so a GIS shapefile, and that calculates automatically the surface And if you don't have an opportunity to get such a shapefile, you can do it on the system. You zoom into the map and you draw yourself your shape as detailed as you wish by just with a cursor going on the map and create your shapefile in this way. It's quite fun to do that if you have time to do it, but most of you will have obviously a GIS shapefile from another source. And the scale of your map, your picture map, so a map which was shown, which you send us as a picture, the scale of it is explained in the strategic framework. It depends how large your Ramsar site is. So if it's larger, then maybe an overall map is helpful, and more specific detailed maps, especially if there are different parts of the Ramsar site. But that depends on the extent of the Ramsar site in general. So Isabel, did you see the different questions? Maybe I'm reading it and then you can answer. In the species section regarding justification, just to write that the species is breeding doesn't really seem to be a proper justification in my view. Do you want to respond to that one?
Yes. Well, the justifications for each criterion are explained in detail in the strategic framework. So I would strongly encourage everybody to take a look at that. For criterion 4, I think breeding is mentioned as one of the justifications. Also, if you click on justification, maybe I can show you, maybe I can share my screen again, that might help.
Yes, please do.
Share. Okay. If we go to criteria, you can see again the different criteria for criterion 4. So criterion 4 is support during critical life cycle stage or in adverse conditions. Oh, wrong tab. So usually there's a, where's the question mark? I cannot find the question mark. I think breeding for criterion 4 is a good justification, as this is an important stage of the life cycle of this species, and more details are in the strategic framework, as I mentioned. So for the criteria, you can always look at the help section, and then it will give you information on what a certain criterion requires, also examples, and directly the link to the strategic framework. And you can refer to the sections that are mentioned here. So I hope that answered this. So whenever you see a question mark, I would recommend to see what's behind it, and it might give you the solution. If not, if you disagree, I'm happy to receive your emails or calls, and we can discuss and find a solution.
Yes, we have still three questions which I would like to briefly address, and then we will probably also come back to individuals of you with a written answer. One is about pending RISs, which were submitted since May last year. I'm thinking it's coming from the Asian region, so we will check with our colleagues and coming back to you. There is one of more general interest in case of boundary adjustment. When it's an update and you click that the boundary has been adjusted, there are three options here in principle. One is that clearly you have extended the Ramsar site because you have added a big part to it. And we will publish this as an extension, and we will recognize that this country has expanded, make the Ramsar site bigger. The contrary can happen as well, but it's rather rare that you restrict it, that you have taken out part of the Ramsar site, out part of the wetland for a overriding national interest, which you have to write down what is the overriding national and urgent interest according to Article 2.5 of the Convention. But it is also possible. And then what probably happens most, if you are changing the boundary or the shapefile for many different reasons, but and the changes maybe net a little bit more or net a little bit less, that we consider as just administrative adjustments, because the boundary was not very well done at the beginning. You have to adjust it to the new road, or you have taken out some agricultural fields or non-wetland areas. So this is just done when you update the RAS and you say that is for administrative reasons and just note it, and there will be no further issue about that. We obviously calculate with the new surface and use the new map, but that's it. So these are the three questions. As we said, you should click this in the RS and we can sort it out together. Then there is a question which I think we have to check on our side and come back to you for references, if one can use a new software, EndNote or Mendeley, for easy referencing. We have to ask with our technical people if that can be included and how. So that we will give you an answer at a later stage when we have clarified this. And I think that was most of what I have seen coming in.
Maybe I can give a brief frame.
We hope obviously you can fill in all new information or updated information as soon as possible, but from the system, there is no limit. But we will, as you know, we are reporting every year to Standing Committee and every 3 years to each COP. What is the situation, the status of Ramsar sites, and also how many of your Ramsar sites are out of date, or the information is out of date, or how many have been updated, or how many have been designated new. So again, this information is made publicly available, so it's probably better not to spend too much time on it, and what we obviously try on our end as well. I think we are a little bit over time already, but if somebody wants to ask an oral question, this is the moment. Okay, so I think then I hope this was useful. As I said, there are these short videos which you can find and more tutorials. And if you have any further questions, just send an email to the relevant email in your region. So if not, I'm thanking you for your attention. I'm thanking Isabel and also Kati and Manuel, my colleagues, who were here for the techniques and make sure that it works fine, and wish to be in contact soon again. Have a good evening or day, and bye-bye.
Thanks, bye.